Okay, let's start. In the last class, we were talking about the scale invariant feature transform, and we have discussed the scale space extrema detection, and then we got a number of stable points or interest point on the scale spaces. Okay, after that, after getting the set of stable points, we employed outlier rejection. So there are two different levels of outlier rejections. At the initial step, we use Taylor series expansion. Okay, and after applying Taylor series expansion on the stable points, we can reject some outliers which are not actually the stable points or interest point. Okay, so this point may include low contrast candidate and poorly localized candidate along an edge. So in the next step, we can further employ outlier rejection approach. So here in this step, we get a strong response along edges. Okay, so basically difference of Gaussian has strong response along edges, and if we assume that difference of Gaussian is a surface, then we compute the principal curvature. Okay, we compute the principal curvature along the edge. One of the principal curvature is very low, okay, and across the edge is high. So as I said in the last class, that along the edge we should whatever the interest point we obtain along the edge, we should discard those points because the principal curvature is found to be very low along the edges. Okay, and across the edge, the principal curvature is found to be high. Now, since this SIP descriptor is analogous to Harris-Kondner detector, so therefore, first we compute the Hessian matrix of difference of Gaussian. Okay, so here we compute the Hessian matrix. So Hessian matrix is nothing but the second order derivative along x axis, along x direction, along y direction. Okay, and then we get the derivative along diagonal directions. So from this Hessian matrix, we obtain the trace and determinant. Okay, so we compute the trace and determinant, and trace is nothing but the sum of diagonal derivatives, and which also can be represented by the sum of eigenvalues. Okay, so here lambda 1 and lambda 2 are two eigenvalues, so trace is nothing but the sum of eigenvalues. Okay, and we also compute the determinant. So here we determinant can also be represented by eigenvalues. So here lambda 1 into lambda 2. So this also gives us the determinant. So this trace and determinant may produce a kind of matrix. So from this, so since here diagonal values, the derivative, partial derivatives along diagonal direction, along x and y direction. So this also gives this also can be represented by the eigenvalues. So here we can use these eigenvalues in place of the partial derivatives along diagonal directions and along x and y direction. So here after removing some outliers in the first step or in the first initial rejection step, so after removing some point, we also need to find some more points which are not actually the stable interest point. Okay, so we get the ratio between trace and determinant. So here you can see that r plus 1 squared divided by r. So this ratio will give us some value. Okay, now if we put r equals to 1, this is found to be minimum when r equals to 1, okay, and it increases with r. So when we increase the value of r, that means if we consider r equals to 1, then we get 4 is to 1. This ratio becomes 4 is to 1. If we increase the value of r, let's say we consider r equals to 2, then if we put r equals to 2, then we will get the ratio 9 is to 1. Okay, and we can further eliminate the key points if r is found to be greater than 10. Okay, so here r is nothing but the ratio between lambda 1 and lambda 2. So here we can eliminate the key points if r is found to be 10. So here 10 is the threshold value, and 10 is the threshold value. So if we get the ratio for some stable key points is less than 10, then we keep that point in the keep that point or consider that point as a stable point. Otherwise, if we find that the value of R is found to be greater than the threshold, then we can eliminate those key points. Okay. Now here you can see that at the initial step we obtain 832 initial key points. Okay, so these key points are detected on this image, and after employing the first step outlier rejection, we get 729 key points. That means some points are removed from the set of stable points. And after employing the second step outlier rejection, okay, using trace and determinant to get the ratio R, we can have 536 key points. So here two steps outlier rejections are employed. So after removing the false stable points, we can obtain a reduced number of interest points. So with this reduced number of interest points, now we will obtain the orientation, and we describe the pattern with the key point descriptor. Now in the third step of SIP descriptor, we will assign the orientation to each stable point. Okay, so after outlier rejection, we obtain the reduced number of key points. Okay, now on this reduced number of key points, for each and every key point, we will assign the orientation. Okay, so how this orientation assignment is done? So first of all, we will compute the central derivatives, and then we obtain the gradient magnitude and direction of the interest point. Okay, so if we consider the our key point is located at x comma y, then first we obtain the gradient magnitude m of x comma y. So first we obtain the partial derivative along x direction, partial derivative along y direction. Then we get the sum of those partial derivatives, and obtain the gradient magnitude m. Okay, so after getting the gradient magnitude, we compute the direction of key point at x comma y. Okay, so after obtaining the magnitude and direction or orient direction, then we create a histogram of local gradient direction at selected scale. Okay, that means now we create a histogram around each selected scale or selected key point. Then we assign the canonical orientation at peak of smooth histogram. So here each key specifies stable 2D coordinates x comma y, scale and orientation. Okay, that means if we consider a SIP point or SIP descriptor, then each point can be represented by four information: the x coordinate, y coordinate, scale and orientation. Okay, that means xy represent the location of the key point, scale represent the magnitude, gradient magnitude, and orientation represent the direction of key point x comma y. So along with this information, we also obtain the key point descriptor. Okay, and this key point descriptor describe the whole pattern with the number of stable key points that are detected from an image. Okay, so here we create a weighted direction histogram. What is weighted directed histogram? So if we consider a neighborhood around a stable key point, okay, then here we can see that for the sake of understand, here we consider 4x4 neighborhood. In this 4x4 neighborhood, for each point, for each point or each pixel around a stable key point, we get the direction. Okay, direction with gradient magnitude. So gradient magnitude nothing but the length of this arrow. So here you can see the different arrows of different lengths. Okay, so this length is nothing but the gradient magnitude. Okay, and direction is also indicated. So here weight will be found to be maximum for a certain point where the gradient magnitude is found to be very high. Okay, found to be very high. So here we try to find the dominating direction. Okay, so here we try to find the dominating direction of a point around the stable key points that has been detected on the scale space. So here we consider the 36 bins. 36 bins means if we divide the 360 degree into 36 bins, then for each bin we get 10 degree. That means so 10 degree, we divide the whole 32 degree into 36 bins, and then we try to compute the gradient magnitude is already obtained, and then we compute the direction. So what are the points which come to a particular direction, and along those directions we try to find the dominating direction. Okay, and that dominating direction will be the direction of the stable key point around which this neighborhood has been described or defined. Okay, so more weights will be given to the dominating direction, because at that directions we get the maximum gradient magnitude. Okay, so maximum gradient magnitude means along that direction the length of the arrow will be maximum. Okay, so here we get the arrow of different sizes. So here we sum up all such gradient magnitudes and get the dominating. So you may consider that on the 10 degree or 20 degree or 30 degree or 40 degree. So in 40 degree we may have get the dominating orientation, because most of the neighborhoods around that stable key points are having the direction along 40 degree. Okay, that means most of the gradient magnitudes are found between 30 degree and 40 degree. Therefore, we can get the dominating direction or dominating orientation along 40 degree direction. Okay, and that dominating direction will be the direction of the detected key point around which we define the neighborhood. So as you can see that here we select a peak as direction of the key point, and here we introduce the key points at local peaks of the histogram with different directions. So here you can see that. So if we divide 360 degree into 8 different regions, then for every region, we will get the direction of the key points around the stable key points or in the neighborhood. So from this histogram you can pick the direction which has got the magnitude of gradient higher than the other magnitude of directions in the other directions. Okay, so here we get the dominating direction from this histogram, and that dominating direction will be the direction of the key point. So after assigning the orientation to every, now we will find the key point descriptor around those detected stable key points. Okay, so here you can see that here. So for sake of the understand, we take a 16 by 8 by 8 neighborhood. Okay, so in this 8 by, actually we take 16 by 16 neighborhood around each key point, but due to constraint here we can understand the same phenomena with 8 by 8 neighborhood. Okay, now this 8 by, first we define the 8 by 8 neighborhood around each key point that has been detected on the scale space. Okay, and then we get 2 by 2 we divide this whole neighborhood into 2 by 2 regions, and from these 2 by 2 regions we get 2 by 2 histogram. Okay, so here you can see that the neighborhood is divided into 8 different directions. So each direction, so 45 degree, 0 degree, 45 degree, 90 degree, then 135 degree, 180 degree, and so on. So here we have got 8 different 8 bins. So under this condition we will find the gradient magnitude, then we find the direction, okay, and we find the dominating direction, and then we get, since here 8 bin histogram is used, so therefore and here we 4 by 4 arrays are obtained for 16 by 16 neighborhood, and for here 8 by 8 neighborhood we obtain 2 by 2 arrays. Okay, 2 by 2 arrays of 2 by 2 arrays of 8 bins. So if we consider 16 by 16, that means for 16 by 16, so 8 bin histogram is used. So 8 into, so if we want to get a 128 features for one key points in the descriptor, then we have to multiply this 8 with 16. Okay, so if we multiply 8 with 16, since 4 by 4 arrays or 4 by 4 histograms 4 by 4 histograms are obtained with 8 bins, so therefore we will obtain the arrays of 4 by 4 and this to be multiplied with the 8 bin histogram. Okay, that means in 8 different directions we get this 4 by 4 arrays for 16 by 16 neighborhood. Therefore we are going to multiply 16 with 8, and when we multiply 16 with 8 we get a vector of 128 elements or 128 features. Okay, and these features, 128 features, is obtained for one stable key points. That means this 128 features will describe the neighborhood intensity change, neighborhood distortion around that key point, around the stable key points. Okay, so basically this key point descriptor gives us the information about the about image distortion, about neighborhood pixel value changes, so about illumination, about rotation, and all that proper, all this image constant due to which the image matching cannot be performed well. Okay, so to get the invariant point we need to obtain this feature descriptor of 128 elements around each key point. Okay, and with this key point we can extend this phenomena for different sizes of neighborhoods. So we can start from 8 by 8 neighborhood, then we can go for 16 by 16, 32 by 32, 64 by 64, so as per the dimension of the image. Okay, so we can extend this phenomena for different neighborhood. Now, what are the different applications of SIFT? After getting the stable key points and the key point descriptor, we can take this key point descriptor as the feature set. Okay, so thereafter, removing the outliers, finally here we obtained 536 key points for the image of dimension 233 by 189. Okay, so this is the dimension of the original image, and from when shift descriptor is applied on this gray level image, finally we obtain 536 key points. Okay, now these 536 key points, we will obtain 536 key point descriptor. Okay, and when we arrange this key point descriptor in the form of two-dimensional matrix, then each row will contain 128 elements. Okay, that means there will be 536 rows. So these 536 rows correspond to the 536 key points. So therefore, the final feature, the dimension of the final feature vector becomes 536 by 128. Okay, so this will be the final vector or final feature vector of dimension 536 by 128. So every key point descriptor generates a vector of 128 elements. Okay. Now, what are the different applications of shift descriptor? So we can apply the shift descriptor for image alignment. So here, image alignment, the homography fundamental matrix. So for image alignment or image registration, we can use this invariant feature descriptor. So we can also use for 3D reconstruction. Okay, for motion tracking, for object recognition, indexing and database retrieval, robot navigation, and there are many other applications in computer vision for which we can apply this invariant shift descriptor. You have any questions from this part? If you have any questions, you can ask me. As I said that there are four different steps in the shift descriptor. So in the first step, we obtain the scale space, and then in the second step, we obtain the stable key points. And with that, with finding the stable key points, we obtain the reduced number of key points by removing the outliers into two different steps. And in the third step, we obtain the orientation of each key points that has been detected on the scale space. And finally, we obtain the key point descriptor. Okay. So if you have any questions from this part, you can ask me now. Otherwise, I will continue the discussion with other local descriptors. So we will start other local descriptors. If you have any questions from this part, you can ask me. Wait, I'm just coming. The next local points or local descriptor that we are going to discuss So here we will introduce the local descriptors. So here SIFT is also a local descriptor. SIFT is working on regional information, and we can have some other local descriptors. They are based on the structural information of the image or structural information of the pattern. Now, what is local descriptor? So local descriptors basically describe the local neighborhood of the image. Okay, and local descriptors are non-parametric descriptors. We know about the parametric equation and non-parametric equation. So when you consider the parametric equation, parametric equation is employed on the independent variables or independent parameters. But non-parametric equation is employed on dependent variable. So that becomes the continuous functions or continuous, and this non-parametric equations are based on the continuous variables. Okay, so local descriptors are non-parametric descriptors, describe local structure at local level. Okay, so local structure means basically we try to find the structural information at local level, and this structural information, when we obtain the structural information, this structural information is invariant to occlusion, invariant to illumination, invariant to scale, and some kind of image distortion. So basically, these local descriptors are found to be very effective or useful for the image which has some variations like scale or illumination, occlusion, and image distortion. So since these local descriptors are local descriptors work on local level or regional level, so therefore at a regional level, so these local descriptors are found to be very invariant to scale, illumination, occlusion, and image distortion. Okay, so local descriptors can also be called as image patch that differs from its immediate surroundings by texture, color, or intensity. Okay, and these local descriptors have major applications in object recognition. Now, what are the different types of local descriptors that we can see in computer vision? So we can have local binary pattern. Then we can have modified local binary pattern. So local binary pattern, local graph structures, local ternary pattern, these are the basic local descriptor from which we can obtain the different variant of those local descriptors. Okay, so here modified local binary pattern, multi-block local binary pattern, these two are the variant of local binary pattern. Okay, so we will start our discussion with local binary pattern first, then we will see how to obtain the uniform local binary pattern, and after discussing that we will discuss about two variants of local binary pattern, that is modified local binary pattern and multi-block local binary pattern. So after that we will talk about local graph structure. Local graph structure is another local descriptor which is based on the graph for every pixel with the neighborhood pixels. Okay, so this graph is obtained for every pixel in the image in the local neighborhood, and this graph is the directed graph. Okay, so in this directed graph there will be one center point around which this directed graph is obtained, and from this directed graph we obtain some useful information, and which is found to be invariant to illumination, invariant to local image distortions. So all these local descriptors are basically LBP. So whether it is LBP, MLBP, MBLBP, or LGS. Okay, so all these local descriptors are invariant to illumination. That means whatever the illumination condition, the relative difference between the neighborhood pixels will not be changed. If the pixel values will be changed, then the gradient difference between the neighborhood pixels so will not be changed. So So what about the illumination condition? What about the image distortion? What about the scale? So at so and what about the scale? What about the orientation? So these local descriptors all are found to be very useful and invariant to this image constraint. Now let us consider the 3x3 matrix. Okay, this 3x3 matrix is given to us, and from this 3x3 matrix we will obtain the local binary pattern. Okay, so local binary pattern is basically based on two phenomena. The first is called the pattern itself, and the strength of the pattern. Okay, so these two information are basically based on these two information or based on these two phenomena, local binary pattern was developed. And local binary pattern uses a small neighborhood, for example 3x3, 5x5. So we can extend this neighborhood size from 3x3 to 3x3 to the neighborhood of circular form. And whenever we get a circular form of these neighborhood points, then we will have the different radius. So if we consider this eight neighborhood in 3x3 image subregion around a point, around a center point 95, then this eight neighborhood will form a circle. Okay, and here radius will be one, because from the center point 95 to any other neighborhood point will have distance one. Okay, so therefore here we consider the radius is one for the circular neighborhood around the center point 95. So here the neighborhood size is 3x3. Okay, and if we want to obtain the local binary pattern, and then we have to use the center point as the threshold. Okay, so by thresholding we can obtain this local binary pattern. So that means with center, the center value is given as 95. This 95 will be compared with all the neighborhood pixels. That is, if we start from the top left corner is having the grayscale value 100. Okay, this 100 will be compared with the center pixel 95. Then 219 will be compared with 95. 10 will be compared with 95. And after that, after getting the difference, that means first we obtain the relative difference between 100 and 95, 200, 19 and 95, 10 and 95. Okay, so here 95, here 100 will be, so 95 will be subtracted from 100, 95 will be subtracted from 219. So in this way, first we obtain the relative difference of neighborhood pixels and center pixel, and then we assign the binary digit 0 or 1 according to the sign of the relative difference. Okay, so since here 100 is found to be greater than 95, therefore the relative distance seems to be positive. So therefore, for positive relative difference we assign 1. Okay, for 219 we assign 1. For 10 is found to be less than 95, therefore we assign 0 for this relative difference. So 56 is found to be less than 95, therefore for negative relative difference we assign 0. So in this way we will get the eight binary digits around this center point 95. Okay, and if we start from top left corner, that means if we start from top left corner, then we can get the binary number along clockwise direction. Okay, so if we go clockwise direction, then first we obtain one, then the next digit will be one, next digit will be three zeros. Okay, then we will obtain two ones, and finally we will obtain one zero. Okay, so this eight binary digits will constitute a binary number. Okay, and if we convert this binary number into a decimal, then we will obtain a decimal number for a neighborhood around any pixel in the image. Okay, now how many such binary numbers we can obtain from this neighborhood? If we consider 3x3 neighborhood around any pixel in the image, then for 3x3 neighborhood, how many such binary numbers will be obtained? Or we can determine these binary numbers for these eight neighborhoods. Depending upon the sign of the relative difference, we can assign either 0 or 1. Okay, that means there are two different digits that we can assign, binary digits that we can assign depending upon the relative difference that we determine while we compare the center pixel with the neighborhood pixels. Okay, since your binary digits are two, so either 0 or 1 can be assigned. And how many neighborhood pixels are found around any pixel? So there are eight neighborhood pixels. Okay, so 2 to the power 8, that means the number of, so the combinations will be here, we will obtain 2 to the power 8. That means 2 to the power 8 number of binary pattern can be obtained from a 3 by 3 neighborhood. Okay, in the 3 by 3 neighborhood, we will have eight neighborhood pixels around the center pixels. So this is just the beginning. That means if we consider the top left corner as the starting point, so from this starting point, if we go the clockwise direction, then we will obtain one binary pattern or one binary number. So we can start from any position. Okay, we can start from any position. We can go either clockwise or anticlockwise, whatever the direction. So all possible combination will give us the binary number, which is 2 to the power 8. Okay, so either 0 or 1 can be assigned, and there are eight neighborhood pixels. So therefore, 2 to the power 8 combinations will be possible for 3 by 3 neighborhood, okay, or 3 by 3 subregion. So initially, we have to divide the image into a number of subregions of size 3 by 3 or 3 by 3 neighborhood. Okay, and then for every pixel around those neighborhood points, we will obtain this local binary pattern. And after getting the local binary pattern, so this binary pattern is converted into decimal number, and this decimal number is obtained for each and every pixel in the image. If we consider 200 by 200, if we consider 200 by 200 pixels, which are found in a grayscale image, then this grayscale image will give us 40,000 binary number for a single pattern. Okay, single pattern means the starting point is fixed. If we try to find another pattern by changing the starting point, then we can also have the 40,000 such binary patterns. Okay, now this 40,000 binary pattern means 40,000 decimal numbers, and these decimal numbers from this decimal number, 40,000 decimal numbers, we will obtain a histogram. Okay, and finally this histogram will be used for matching. So here you can see this formulation of local binary pattern. So here we get the sum, and this sum is obtained on the relative difference, which is multiplied by 2 to the power 2 to the power p. Here P is capital P is the number of neighborhood points. Okay, and we can start from 0, 0 to p minus 1. So here we get the relative difference r of gp minus gc. So here gc is the center pixel, gp is the neighborhood pixel. Okay, and this relative difference is multiplied by 2 to the power p. Okay, so here relative difference r of gp minus gc is multiplied with 2 to the power p, capital P. So here capital P is the number of neighborhood points. So neighborhood points may be 8 on a circular neighborhood region. If we consider the 8 neighborhood is a 8 neighborhood points are on a circle, then this circular region may be extended for 16 pixels, may be extended for 8 pixels also. So here we can see that here we can have the different circular regions around a pixel, around a pixel point. Okay, so center point is given. Around the center point we can have 3 by 3 neighborhood. If we consider, if we extend the size of the neighborhood, okay, then we can have the neighborhood size of 5 by 5. So in the 5 by 5 neighborhood we will get 16 neighborhood points, and this 16 neighborhood point will be on the circle. Okay, and in this case the radius will be 2, because from every neighborhood point that is the length of the center point will be 2. Okay, that means 2 points gap will be there for every neighborhood point from the center pixel. But in case of 3 by 3 neighborhood, if the 3 by 3 neighborhoods are lie on this circle, then the radius will be 1. Okay, so basically this is made the generic this is made the generic for different neighborhood, and for different neighborhood the radius may be different. Okay, if we fix the radius, then we can obtain the different neighborhood points. Like if we consider the radius 2, for radius 2 we can obtain either 16 neighborhood or 8 neighborhood. Okay, that means either we can consider 8 neighborhood or we can consider 16 neighborhood. But in case of radius 1, we only obtain 8 neighborhood points around that pixel point or around that pixel. Okay. Now the relative distance, depending upon the relative distance, we will assign one or either 1 or 0. So here, if the x is found to be greater than 0, then we assign 1. When x is found to be less than 0, then we assign 0. Okay, and from this binary pattern, so from this formulation we obtain the binary pattern, and once the binary pattern is obtained, and then we go for the histogram. Histogram means after getting the binary pattern, and then we obtain the decimal values for each and every pixel point in the image, and for every pixel point in the image we obtain this histogram, and this histogram is used for a matching purpose in case of object recognition and in case of pattern matching. So we will use this histogram for as a final feature vector or final feature points which are to be matched for the object recognition or pattern matching. Here you can see an input face image, and we obtain the local binary pattern image. This local binary pattern is obtained by replacing the original pixel values with the decimal values. Okay, when those decimal values are replaced, the original pixel values, then we obtain this LBP image. Okay, and this is the corresponding histogram that we are obtained from LBP image. That means if we obtain the histogram from this LBP image, then the histogram will be look like this. So Yeah, the components are found to be very different from the regular histogram, because all binary patterns are converted into decimal numbers, and the behavior of these decimal numbers will be found to be as clustered-like regions. Okay, and these cluster-like regions are formed on this LBP image. But if you see an LBP image, then you cannot visually identify those regions. But if we see the histogram components in the histogram, then it is clearly visible that some clusters have been created in the LBP image. Okay, here you can see the second example. We have input image, we have LBP image, and we obtain the LBP histograms. And these are called the extended LBP. In the extended LBP, we can have the neighborhood of different sizes with the different radius. Okay, and we can use this generic formulation. This is XP, XP for X component and YP for Y component. Okay. So XP means that we obtain the X coordinate and YP for Y coordinate, and use this generic formulation for extended LBP. Now, what is uniform pattern? So we can extend this LBP pattern to generate a uniform patterns. Okay, so uniform pattern is the number of bitwise transitions from 0 to 1 or vice versa. That means we can consider the transition from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, okay, in the local binary pattern, and then we obtain the uniform pattern. So when these transitions are considered, the transitions are considered on the circular bit pattern. Okay, circular bit pattern. So here a local binary pattern is called uniform if its uniformity measure is at most 2. So at most 2 means we want to see 2 transitions. So not if we if there is more than 2 transitions, then those binary patterns will be discarded. That means those binary patterns are not the uniform binary pattern or uniform pattern. Okay, so at most 2 transitions will be there in the binary local binary pattern. So if we consider such patterns where we have at most 2 transitions, then these patterns will be called the uniform binary patterns, or rest of the patterns which are having more than 2 transitions, then those patterns will be called non-uniform pattern. That means these patterns are not uniform patterns. Now, why we want to obtain the uniform pattern? Because this when we consider a uniform pattern, this uniform pattern is invariant to rotation. So therefore, this is useful addition in the local binary pattern. So local binary pattern itself is invariant to illumination. Okay, if you want to make it invariant to rotation also, then we have to obtain the uniform pattern. And uniform pattern considers at most 2 transitions, from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0. Okay, so other transitions will not be considered. So uniform pattern may contain 0 transition, uniform pattern may contain 1 transition, and uniform pattern may contain at most 2 transitions, and rest of the transitions in the local binary pattern will not be considered as uniform patterns. So now we have made the local binary pattern invariant to illumination, invariant to rotation, and some way if we extend this uniform pattern, then we can obtain the other binary pattern, and that are to be invariant to other image constraints like scale, okay, image distortion. So we can make it invariant to image constraints, so which are found problematic while the object recognition or pattern matching is performed. Okay, So if we consider here the first pattern for uniform, first pattern for transitions, then here you can see that all 8 bits are 0. So here we have 0 transitions. Okay. If we consider the second pattern, that is 0, then the first digit is 0. Then we have 3 ones, then we have 4 ones. Okay. So these 8 binary bits constitute a local binary pattern. So here we can have two transitions. Why two transitions? So we will consider the first binary bit. Here we consider the first binary bit 0, and then we have 1. Okay, so 0 to 1, 1 transition, and then we will consider the second transition from 1 to 0. Okay, so fourth bit is 1, fifth bit is 0. So there is one transition from 1 to 0. This is one transition, and 0 to 1, another transition. So here we have two transitions. Okay. Now, if we consider the third binary pattern, that is 11001, then we have 4 ones. Then, if we consider the second bit 1, okay, here second bit, then second bit to third bit we have one transition. From fourth bit to fifth bit we have another transitions. So here we have two transitions. Now, what are the non-uniform patterns? Here, if we consider these two binary pattern 11001001, so here we have four transitions. Because if we consider the second bit 1, then from second bit to third bit we have one transition. Then from fourth bit to fifth bit we have another transition. From fifth to sixth we have another transition, and from seventh to eighth we have another transition. So there are four transitions. Okay, so we are getting these transitions that to be considered from left to right. Okay, from left to right, so we will start the scanning the bits in the binary pattern from left, and we will finish our scanning operation at the right. Okay, so we will start from left, then go towards right, and try to find the transitions. So in case of non-uniform transition, here we have seen in the first binary pattern we have four transitions. In the second binary pattern we have six transitions. So these binary patterns are not uniform binary patterns. Now, what are the different textures that LBP gives? Okay, so we can have a spot. So here, these neighborhood points are given in circular form. Here you can see that, and every white pixels denotes every white pixel denotes the neighborhood. Every black and white pixels denote the neighborhood points. Okay, so we can have the spot, we can have the flat region, we can have line. Okay, we can have edge, we can have corner points. So all such texture primitives can be obtained from local binary pattern, and such binary and such textures have some specific patterns in the image. And we can and when these patterns are matched to when these patterns are matched to the specified patterns, then we can classify these textures according to the according specific binary pattern that are obtained around pixel points. Okay, that means after observing the neighborhood points around every pixel in the image, we can identify or we can classify the textures that are formed in the image. Okay. Now we'll talk about the modified local binary pattern. Now, what is the modified local binary pattern? So, in the modified, in the earlier case, we have seen that in LBP pattern, we only get one binary pattern, and that binary pattern is converted into decimal number, and from that decimal number, we obtain a histogram. Okay. Now, here we have the modified local binary pattern. In modified local binary pattern, here we try to decouple the information. Decouple the information means we try to obtain the more information from the same pattern. Okay. So here we can obtain the sign magnitude. Here we can obtain the sign pattern and magnitude pattern. So same pattern is divided into two different patterns. One is called the sign pattern, another is called the magnitude pattern. Okay. Now let us take an example. Here we have got 3x3 neighborhood, and if we try to find the sign component of the modified local binary pattern, and then we get the relative difference, and this relative difference may be positive, may be negative, okay, depending upon the center value of this neighborhood. And based on the sign of the relative difference, we can assign minus one or one. Okay, so minus one is assigned to is assigned to negative relative difference, and for positive relative difference we can assign one. Okay, and for magnitude component, here we consider only the absolute value of the absolute value relative difference. That means we obtain the relative difference, take the absolute of that relative difference, irrespective of sign of this relative difference. We can assign 0 or 1 according to the relative, the absolute relative difference, and we obtain another pattern. Okay, so first we obtain another one pattern for sign component and another pattern for magnitude component, and then we obtain this binary pattern. So binary pattern for sign component and binary pattern for magnitude component. Okay, here we can see the formulation. So if the distance is found to be greater than equals to 0, then we assign 1. If the distance, that is relative distance, is found to be less than 0, then we obtain minus 1. Okay, and this magnitude pattern is obtained by taking the absolute value of this relative difference between center pixel and the neighborhood pixels. Okay, so for sign component we obtain one pattern, and for magnitude component we obtain another pattern. Then we generate two different binary images or binary patterns for sign component and magnitude component, and then we can use these two different binary patterns for matching purpose. Either we can combine these two binary patterns, or we can use these two binary patterns separately for pattern matching or object recognition. The next variant is multi-block local binary pattern. Now, what happens in multi-block local binary pattern? Here we first we divide the image into a number of 3x3 neighborhoods or 3x3 subregions. Then for each subregion, we obtain the average value. Okay, we obtain the average value. That means if there are 8 pixels in the 8 pixels in the neighborhood of 3x3 image block, then we will obtain the average value for each block, and then we obtain a 3x again we obtain 3x3 neighborhood. Okay, 3x3 modified neighborhood. So this modified neighborhood is obtained from nine image block or image subregions. So here we have nine regions. So from nine regions we obtain 9 pixels, and these 9 pixels will constitute the modified 3x3 neighborhood. And this now this when we obtain the modified 3x3 neighborhood, so from this modified 3x3 neighborhood we obtain a binary pattern. This binary pattern is obtained after applying local binary pattern operator on this modified neighborhood. So after getting the binary pattern, we obtain the decimal numbers, and from those decimal numbers, for every image block, we obtain a histogram. So here you can see some examples of multi-block LVP. So here we can see the visible image, and if we apply the multi-block LVP, on 9x9 neighborhood, then we obtain one binary pattern. And if we apply multi-block LVP on 24x24 subregions on neighborhood, then we obtain another binary pattern. Okay, so 9x9 means we will consider 9x9 neighborhoods, okay, in an image block. That means if we consider an image block of 9x9 neighborhood, that means there will be 9x9 3x3 nine neighborhoods, okay, 3x3 nine neighborhoods will be there in that image block. So such image blocks are considered on the whole image, and we divide that image into 9x9 blocks, into a number of 9x9 blocks. Okay, so that means we can either consider 9x9 block, or we can consider 24x24 block. So we can extend this phenomena further for getting the image block of different sizes. Okay, so we can start from 9x9, then we can go for 24x24, then we can obtain another neighborhood. That means in every image block we should have nine 3x3 neighborhood, or we can have 24x24 neighborhood of size 3x3. Okay, so next is local graph structure. So now if we consider local graph structure, so local graph structure is found to be more advantageous than local binary pattern, because local binary pattern is limited to the center pixel around which a neighborhood is defined. Okay, now if we want to have more information in the feature vector, then we can apply the local graph structure instead of local binary pattern, because local graph structure gives more information than local binary pattern. And there are many variants of this local graph structure, but since local graph structure is the basic operator in the local descriptors, similar to local binary pattern, then we will discuss our discussion with local graph structure. Okay, and once we understand the local graph structure, we can obtain our own variant that to be useful for matching and object recognition. Okay, so now local graph, how this local graph is formed. So local graph is formed around a pixel point that to be considered in the image. Okay, so here you can see that we have considered a pixel point which is assigned by 7. Okay, so the pixel value is 7, so grayscale value is 7. Okay, so 7 is considered as the pixel around which the local graph structure is formed. Okay, so 7, then we get the next pixel point 9. Since this is the directed graph, so we will start from 7, then we go clockwise. Okay, that means if we go clockwise, then we obtain 9, then we obtain pixel 5. Again, we come to the same point from which we started. Okay, and when we arrive this center pixel, or the point around which the local graph structure is formed, we can go to the left, we can go to the right. Then we reach the pixel 6, and then we go to the pixel 7. Okay, then that means after reaching pixel 6, we make our journey in the clockwise direction. Okay, so from pixel 6 we go to 7, then we go to another pixel 7. Okay, and from that pixel we return back to the pixel 6. So First, we obtain the pixel. First, we obtain the pixels in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay, and after that, we obtain the pixels in the clockwise directions. So this formation, or basically this, this local graph structure will give us a binary pattern. Okay. That means we get the relative difference similar to local binary pattern. So if we get the difference 7 minus 9, so since we are starting from 7, okay, so we get the relative difference 7 minus 9. So 7 minus 9 is negative relative difference. So therefore we assign 0. Okay, then we get the 9 minus 5. So 9 minus gives us the positive relative difference. Therefore we assign 1 to this edge, and 5 minus 7, we get the negative relative difference. So we assign 0 here. So in this way, we can get the binary pattern after getting the relative difference, and based on the relative difference, we can either assign 0 or 1. And after assigning 0 or 1, we obtain a binary pattern. And when we obtain a binary pattern, so from this binary pattern, we can obtain a decimal number. And when this decimal number is obtained for a pixel in the image, then for rest of the pixels, we also have these decimal numbers or binary patterns. And similar to the local binary pattern, after having all the decimal numbers for the number of pixels in the image, we obtain histogram like this. Okay, so this is the example of local graph structure. So first we consider an input image. On this input image, we obtain the local graph structure. And when local graph structure for every pixel is formed, and then we convert this local graph structure into decimal numbers. And when we obtain the decimal numbers, we obtain the histogram components in the histograms. And finally, when these decimal numbers will replace the original pixel values in the image, we obtain a binary pattern which will be look like this. So here you can see the example of local graph structure. So this local graph structure binary pattern or the image is obtained after replacing the decimal numbers, after replacing the original pixel values by the decimal numbers. And these decimal numbers are determined from this formulation. So you can use this formulation. So similar to this is very similar to local binary pattern. So like local binary pattern, we obtain the relative difference. So this is this here relative difference is denoted by S of GD minus GN. Okay, so this is the relative difference. So here GN GD minus GN is the relative difference, and which is multiplied by 2 to the power p. Here p represent the number of neighborhood points around a pixel point. And here we consider the sine of sx. Okay, so we will assign sx equals to 1 when x is found to be greater than 0, and whenever x is found to be less than 0, then we assign 0. Okay, so we consider similar to local binary pattern. Here we obtain 2 to the power 8 8 different combinations. That means if we want to fix at one combination, then that pattern will be considered for rest of the images. Okay, so we can change the combination. We can, by changing the starting points. So we have to fix the starting points, and based on that starting point along with the neighborhood, we obtain the local graph structure, and that local graph structure will give us this local graph binary pattern. Okay, so this local graph based binary pattern is obtained after we fix the combination of the binary digits. So we can start from any point in the graph, but that to be fixed for rest of the pixels also. That means for different pixels in the image, we cannot consider the different combination. The combination of binary bits should be fixed at the beginning. Okay, so we will fix that. We will fix that specific pattern by taking the starting point at some position, and that starting position will be fixed for the rest of the pixels in the image. Okay, if you have any questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, I will stop this discussion now. If you have any questions, you can ask me now. Any questions? When you have end semester exam?
I think 11 January.
11 January. So it will start from 11 January.
Yes, sir.
You have got the notice?
I know, sir. Our Elwood teacher said that.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, then we will meet in the next week. So probably the next week will be the next week. In the next week, we will have our last class. So if your exam will start from 11, then we will have the next week only. So after that, we will decide about the continuous assessment one. So continuous assessment one is not. Continuous assessment is yet to be done. So midterm exam is done, but continuous assessment, that is, I will give you some home assignments in the next week. So on Monday, I will send you all that home assignments. Okay, and you have to submit that the solution of those home assignments by Friday. Next week Friday.
Okay, sir.
Okay. And that home assignment will carry 15 marks. Because earlier midterm exam was held for 25 marks. So now this continuous assessment will have 15 marks. So 25 plus 15, 40 marks exams are done, and your NSEM exam will be on 60 marks, I think. Okay. So in the next week, Monday, I will send you in some assignments, and you will submit the solution of those assignments by next Friday.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay. That's all for today.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.